I want to welcome each one of you, those who are joining us online. God be with each one of you as we study His Word. May His grace and peace be upon us as we understand this ninth lesson. Each one of you, remember, we are doing our lesson study 1 week in advance. So that's why we welcome each one of you throughout this nation and abroad, wherever you are. And we want you to learn God's lesson and be blessed. And all of us who are here at Spicer, and God be with us as we study His Word. Now, is there anyone who can remember the title of our lesson? Anyone? The ninth lesson. Someone. Someone. Pardon?
The most convincing proof.
The most convincing proof. Most convincing proof. Now, anybody notice that now our memory text, the key text of that convincing proof? John chapter
11
verses
51 and 52.
Is there someone who would like to read this one for us from the Bible? It's also printed in our book quarterly. John chapter 11 verse 51 and 52. Someone help us? Is there someone to read for us?
Now yes. This he did not say on his own authority, but being high priest, that year he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not for that nation only, but also that he would gather together in one the children of God who were scattered abroad.
Okay, now these are the words of the high priest in that year which Jesus was crucified. Who was the high priest? Anybody can remember? Who was the high priest at the time of Jesus' death? I know somebody is saying slowly. Who was the high priest?
Caiaphas.
You are right, young man. Caiaphas was the high priest. Now, he was saying, for the whole nation, one man must die. Looks like almost the words of prophecy-like. You see? Now, he was the high priest. Then he was the one who plotted to, with all the other leaders, to crucify Christ. But still he was saying something kind of a prophetic words. Yes, not only for the whole nation, for the whole world. Jesus died. Jesus died. Now, what is the convincing proof for our unity? Definitely, it is the death of Jesus Christ. Death of Jesus Christ, which brought definitely unity among the believers. Unity among the believers. That's why now death of Jesus is a unifying, let us say, factor for each one of us. We are united in Christ, and in His death and resurrection also brings unity. And you remember those disciples, just only the previous day, Jesus was crucified on Friday. That was the day of Passover. And that night, that Thursday night, then at what we call communion service or the Lord's Supper, we call it, the disciples were not united. They were divided. You remember that. But later what happened? Because of Jesus' death, surely they were united together. They came together. And in we read in Acts chapter 1 verse 14 and 15, they prayed together how many days? 10 days. You're right. 10 days they prayed together. With unity. With one heart, one accord. Which means now oneness. That's why definitely Jesus' now death brought definitely unity among the believers at that time. Today also, we need to remember that among the believers, each one of us, that cross must be the main now source of unity. It is the death of Jesus which should bring that unity in us. Because Jesus died for us. Jesus made all the major sacrifice, supreme sacrifice. What are we sacrificing for Christ? what are we sacrificing for Christ? So definitely we need to have that unity. Now, there's also another aspect. Now, we are living in this world. This world is full of what? War, fighting, then now betraying each other. Now, this world is full of all of this one. Now, in this sinful world, all of this war and fighting and let us say opposing each other, betraying each other, maybe talking evil of others, all of these aspects came into this world because of sin. Because of sin. I know before sin, this there was no war, there was no fighting, there is no disagreement. They were all in unity. But after sin entered this world, all of these problems began. We realize that. All of these problems began. But now, in this world of war and fighting and bettering each other, hating each other. I know, people hate each other in various ways because of their color maybe. Maybe because of their economic now disparity. Some are poor and some are very rich. You see? And also because of their maybe now post and position in this world. I know they don't like others who are having no job or having a very, very humble job. I know this kind of now diversity there is. In this situation, as God's people, we must be the people of what? Reconciliation. What is that English word reconciliation means what? Reconciling. Anyone? English word reconciling.
Come together.
To come together. To come together or bring them together. This is what is reconciled. They are divided because of various factors. But as God's people, we must play the role of what? Bringing them together in unity. This is what we call reconciling. That's why, what role do we make? Now, you remember the Beatitudes, which we read in Matthew chapter 5. Then, blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers, which means if you are establishing or bringing peace between two families, between two friends, between two, let us say, persons, or between wife and husband who are having some problem. You see? You are the blessed person. Why? Because we are the sons of who? God. Sons of God. That's why we need to be that peacemakers. Because now Jesus is now described in the Bible as what? In terms of peace. Anyone? He's the Prince of what? Peace. Prince of peace. This is what we can read in Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6. So definitely Jesus is Prince of peace. That means he's the King of peace. He's the one who grants peace as his sons and daughters. In this sinful world, which is full of war and fighting and hating and betraying each other, we must play that role of bringing what? Peace. Bringing peace to the people. That's why we are to play that role of reconciliation. Reconciliation. Reconcile others. What happened? Because of Jesus' death, what happened to us? We are reconciled unto whom? God. You are right. We are reconciled unto God. Because of sin, we are separated. One of the definitions of sin is what? Separation from God. But it is Jesus' death which brought what? Reconciliation between us and God. That's why surely we have to play that role as the children of peace. That's why we should be peacemaker. We should make that peace. And now in order to be the peacemakers, we ourselves must first experience what? That peace in our lives. in our families, in our church, and in our community. We must enjoy that peace. We must practice that peace first. Then only we can be what? People of reconciling or reconciliation. People of peace we can be. So this is what we need to be. Another aspect. This is convincing proof. If you are making peace between those warring people, between those people who are not getting along, then if you can bring peace as a son of God, as a daughter of God, then they can see what? Now, they can see immediate, let us say, now, wonderful relationship in you, wonderful things in you. They will say, ah, here is a person. Here is a person. And he is following. So that's why we have, by looking at us, our life day to day, every day, people can see Jesus in us. People can say, ah, here are the children of God. Here are the children of God. That's why we need to follow this. There's also another aspect. Another aspect. That is now the mind of Christ. Which means Christ is our example. Jesus, now, what kind of mind Jesus had? Let us read in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 and 6. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 and 6. Is there someone to help us to read this one? Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 and 6. Anyone? Anyone to help us?
Let this be mine.
Let this mind be in you, which was also in whom? Lord Jesus Christ. What happened?
Who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God.
Next point. Next verse.
But made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a servant.
Okay, this is what it is. The mind of Jesus is, though he is God, and now, he left that heavenly privileges. He left that throne. And always angels say, holy, holy, holy. They worship him. He left all of that one. He came to this world as a human being. That too, he took the form of what? A rich man or a king or king's son? No. Form of what?
Servant.
A very humble person. Born in Nazareth. No, born in Bethlehem, but... born in an animal shed, then grew up in Nazareth, that wicked place. Born in Bethlehem, in that animal shed, what we call manger. Now, even a common man, even so-called beggar, is not born where? In animal shed. At least, even a beggar is born in a better place than that animal shed. And Christ left all of that one, which means that shows his humility. He is so humble. He humbled himself. Then as God's people, what do we learn? So that people can see that now practical life in us. That is, we need to also practice. We need to also have that humble life. We need to have that humble life. So humble life is very, very essential for us. That's why I want to tell you, my brothers and sisters here as well as online, now, do we humble ourselves as God's children, God's sons and daughters? He left everything. He took the form of a servant and he even took the death on our behalf, the death on the cross. Very painful and shameful death in those days, because they crucified anyone on the roadside naked. So shameful, and also the most painful death we ever know on this earth. You think of any form of punishment for death, whether it is hanging somebody to death or somebody now shooting them to death, or now beheading, that means cutting their head off, now throwing them in the fiery furnace, like in the days of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, or throwing them in the lion's den, like those now Persians. You think of any form of death. In our modern days, they keep somebody on the electric chair and they just switch it on. That means they put on the they turn on that switch. Then the electricity passes through that chair and that person is now electrocuted to death. But among all of these forms of what we call death, then what happens? Cross is the most painful and shameful death. Who accepted that one? Jesus. Jesus took that one for us. That means he humbled himself so much. That's why as we live in this last days, now do we have that kind of humility, humbling ourselves in every aspect, so that when people see in us that humbleness, they can say, here is the daughter of Christ, here is the son of Christ, here are the people who just live like their master in humility, humbleness. This is what we can show to the world, which it desperately needs, because in this world today what we see, there is so much of competition. Sometimes we call this one cutthroat competition, we call it. Which means if there are two shops, each one is competing to make more profit, and also they try their level best to somehow suppress the other, somehow to damage the other. It is happening there in the professional jobs also, whether it is software, whether it is medical profession, even whether it is teaching profession, everywhere it happens. Someone wants to be now higher than the other. Somebody wants to dominate all the others. This is what happens. We live in that kind of a world. So in this kind of now competition for a high position, and competition for recognition, competition for prestige, name and fame, as God's people, surely if we can be living like our master, humble life with humility, I know that can bring solution to a number of problems which the world is facing today. That's why now when people have competition, that brings problems. If somebody wants to be higher, if somebody wants to be their boss at any means, even following some unchristian, unethical and illegal means, maybe suppressing someone, bribing someone, and sometimes in the world they kidnap someone so that the other person will not win that election, or that person will not come for that election. These things are going on in this world. But today, now, what the world needs is that humbleness, that humility. That's why, if we stop doing those things, like as the world is doing, now, trying or competing for each other's, competing to climb the ladder to go to the top place, then most of the problems which we face in the community, at our workplace, would not be there. That's why we need to focus on this one and understand. That's why, let this mind be in you. What was the mind of Jesus? To humble himself, showing humility. On top of that, Jesus' mind also is what? Now, not really climbing for the top position, not at all. Going down to a level of a servant to serve the people. And also, the mind of Jesus is to forgive people. This is what is also needed for us. That is, forgiveness is needed in our lives. To forgive others, even our enemies, forgive them as Jesus did. If we can experience, if we can show those qualities in our lives, then what will happen? Whenever somebody looks at us, and that is a convincing what? proof in our lives, saying, here is someone who is the Son of God. Here is someone, daughter of Jesus. Here is someone, the Son of Jesus. Convincing proof. So we need to humble ourselves and show that forgiveness, attitude of forgiveness. There's also another aspect, that is, in this world we have diversity. What is that diversity? What? Anyone? What is another simple word for diversity? I know there is so much of diversity in these last days, in this world. Anyone? What do you understand by that word diversity?
Variety.
That is good. Any other? That's a good one. I know. Now, in this world what happens is, all the people are not the same, isn't it? Different languages, different color, and different background, different educational background, different economic background. Some are richer, some are poor. And now, we are different. But though we are different, when we accept Jesus, when we live together, still that oneness is lacking. Oneness is lacking. That's why, now in those days itself, Paul recognized the diversity, that means the differences. Because in the church of Rome, there were many Gentiles converted and also Jewish converts. And often Jews and Gentiles could not what? Get along. They could not get along because of their different background. Jewish background, Gentile background. Jewish people were very selective in eating certain things and avoiding certain things not to eat. Because Bible tells us in Leviticus chapter 11, what to eat, what not to eat. Jewish people strictly followed that. But Gentiles, many times, their background is different. And now, they were eating certain things which became some stumbling block to others. That's why Paul realized their problem, their diversity. That's why he was advising. We can read that one in Romans chapter 14 verses 1-5. But definitely a diversity exists. Let us say somebody speaks a different language, somebody is different color than your color, somebody eats different things than what you eat. Let us say somebody is a vegetarian, or on the other hand, or somebody is a non-vegetarian. Now, surely there is difference in your eating. But should that be because of their dress, because of their language, because what they eat, vegetarian or non-vegetarian, should that bring distance between each other believer? And at Rome, something began to happen in this direction, in this manner. That's why Paul advised them. That advice must be followed even now in these last days. Surely, now, because of the technology, because of all the facilities what we have today, the world is becoming like a, what we often say, global village. Which means so much access to go to the other places. Then, when you choose to go to some other place and live there with those people who are different color than your skin color and different language than your own language, then how do you cope up as God's people? How do we cope up? How do we relate to each other? Now, though that skin color or language or the economic differences or cultural differences, whatever is there, but one thing which we should be united in, one thing which we should be saying, all are one. That is who?
Jesus
Christ and His death and resurrection. You see? Jesus is our unifying factor. That's why in this world of now diversity, still we acknowledge, we accept the diversity. Yes. What you speak is not the language of the other person. What we eat as a food is not eaten by everybody. They eat different things. Maybe the same thing, but they prepare in a different way. They cook in a different way. The same potato. The same potato. And they may cook in, they may prepare in a different way. But that should not cause a contention, any kind of differences. And say, in spite of all of that language and color and culture and our habits, we should rise above them and say, we are one in Christ. Christ is our Savior. He died for us. And He's coming soon to take who? Whom He's going to take? All the believers who are faithful to Him, isn't it? Not only one language people, or not only people from one area, all over the world. From every tribe, every language, every nation, we are going to see people in heaven. This is what we have in Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. We want to read that one. Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. Somebody help us. Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. Is there someone to read for us?
After this I beheld.
After this I saw, that is after the sealing of the now 12,000 from each tribe.
And lo, a great multitude.
Lo, a great multitude. That means a big group.
Which no man could number.
Which nobody can number. Oh, no human being can number that.
Of all nations.
All nations. I want you to notice this one.
And kindred.
See, from all nations. All kindred.
And people. And
all
tongues.
Kinds of people.
And tongues.
All different language people.
Stood before the throne.
Okay, they are all standing before. Thank you. They're standing. That means they'll be in heaven. That's why these differences, what we have, diversities, should not separate us. Rather, though we have all of these differences of our language, of our skin color, of our economic background, of our educational differences, all of them put aside. These are all only temporary. But those things should not separate us. But the Christ, our Savior, and His death and resurrection should bring us together to be united. To be united. So that the diversity now in India we have that saying. In India we have that saying. Because we have so many languages. And it is estimated over now hundreds of different dialects in India. And different tribes, different castes, but all of those differences and this many language differences and tribal differences, caste differences and educational and economic differences, but still we use in India one slogan. What is that? Unity in
diversity.
Diversity. You're right. Thank you, young man. Unity in diversity. How true it is in Christ. In spite of our differences, we should be united because of Christ and His death and resurrection. So that's why I want to tell you, we should experience that unity in diversity. Unity in diversity. Lastly, we want to focus on unity in mission. Now, our mission is what? When we say mission, what is the purpose or which, what is the work which Jesus has given to us and went back to heaven? Go into
all nations,
all the world. And as God's people, we are given that last, let us say, command, that great commission, which we read in the first angel's message, Revelation chapter 14, verse 6. What does it say?
Fear God. And
fear God. No, that is verse 7, verse 6. And I saw an angel flying in the mid-sky with an everlasting gospel to whom? To every nation and every tribe and every language people. This is for everyone. That's why our mission is to take the gospel to every village, every town and every city and every nation and all people. Every tribe, every caste, every language people. We need to cover. Not only just a particular one person. In the early church, the Jewish people, most of the converts were Jewish people. They thought, if we evangelize the Jews, that is enough. They thought that way. But later they came to understand, thank God. And they left Jerusalem and Judea and went to the uttermost parts of the world. Surely, we must be united in this mission. The mission is proclaiming the good news of salvation, the everlasting gospel. We have to proclaim the everlasting gospel. Whichever the means you can do, whether you want to do online, whether you are doing a Bible study, whether you are, let us say, one-to-one personal evangelism, that means studying with a person and leading that person to Christ, whatever the means, or distributing some printed messages, what we call tracts, whatever you can do. Do something for the Lord. So we must be united in that, fulfilling the mission of Jesus, which He has given. Then, once we finish that work, unitedly, it cannot be accomplished by only that one church pastor, or those only few church elders, or only those few deacons. This proclamation of the gospel must be done by who? Every who?
Believer.
Every believer. That's why may the Lord bless each one of us so that we will be united in this effort, in this work of mission. So that now anyone who looks at you and me, convincing proof, because Jesus has given this command and say, go into the world and preach. And until and unless this gospel of the gospel reaches the whole world, that means everywhere. And Jesus said, I will not come back second time. The gospel must be preached as a testimony. Then the end will come. Matthew 24:14. We know this text. That's why let us also be united in the mission of Jesus. Yes, the disciples, as we referred to them in the beginning, they did not have that unity in the beginning. But the death and resurrection of Jesus brought unity. After that, they left all of those worldly, selfish interests. They had only one goal: to obey the words of Jesus and to go and evangelize the world, to finish the evangelism, to take the gospel to the uttermost parts of the world. That's what they were united. As we are living in these last days, let us leave all the other diversities, any other selfish interests what we may have. Let us set aside all of them. Why? Jesus is what? Coming soon. Jesus is coming soon. Since Jesus is coming soon, what we ought to do is two things. One, we need to prepare ourselves and our families. That is our first priority. Then also equal priority, though we may say second priority, it is equally important. That is to prepare others. It's sure we may not be able to individually go to the whole world to prepare everyone. At least in that area where you live, or in that village where you live, or in that street where you live, we can accomplish the gospel. But I want you to notice one thing. Jesus only said, okay, this gospel or gospel of the kingdom should be now preached as a testimony. But Jesus did not say, we have to convert the whole world. Did God say that? No, Jesus did not say, you have to convert the whole world, then only I'm going to come back. No. Our part is to proclaim the good news of salvation, which is free in Christ. Then the Holy Spirit will take over. The work of conversion is the work of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit will take care of. That's it. Our part is to proclamation. That is to preach. Then somebody may say, oh, I cannot preach like Paul. Or I cannot preach like so and so. Then what we can do? somebody says, I'm not trained, I'm not a theologian, I didn't study theology, I don't know how to preach, I get scared to preach, I cannot stand in front of people, then what can you do? Anyone?
Give testimony.
Yes, you can give a testimony what Jesus is doing in your life. That is, if somebody says, oh, I have a testimony, but I'm getting scared to stand in front of people, I cannot stand, I'm getting shivering, they say. What you can do? Maybe you can take some printed messages, maybe a few pages. You can distribute, isn't it, to someone. Or you can write down your testimony, what God has done in your life. And you can circulate that one to give it to others. Or if you cannot even do that one, at least in this modern technology, at least you can use your Facebook, isn't it? Or you can create a YouTube. And you can reach out to the people. Do something for the Lord Jesus. Otherwise, Jesus will ask one day and say, what have you done for me? Because Jesus died for us. Then he will say, what have you done for me? Then what will we say? What can I say? What can you say? Can we say boldly and say, Lord, I have done this one for you. I have done this one for your work. I have done this one for your glory. I have done this one for your honor. Can we say something which we have done for Christ? That's why each one of us, we need to do something. That's why, now, if somebody asks that question, what can you do for Jesus? And now, often we sing that wonderful song saying, what are you doing for Jesus? What are you doing for Jesus? What are we doing individually? We need to ask ourselves that question, isn't it? So that, now, let us be united in mission. Let us be united in mission. Take the gospel together and carry this message together in unity, so that the message will reach out to the people. That's why the convincing proof is our day-to-day practical Christian life. Convincing proof is day-to-day practical Christian life. I know in day-to-day, we face so many challenges. In spite of those challenges, it is the Holy Spirit who will guide us. It is the grace of Jesus who will enable us, who will help us to accomplish this wonderful work for the Lord Jesus. That's why, let us live as sons and daughters of Jesus in these last days. Becoming peacemaker, making peace in the community, in the family, in the church. But often what happens, some people become agents of Satan to bring what? Disunity. And ask yourself and say, am I a peacemaker in the church, peacemaker in the community, peacemaker in the family? Or am I bringing disunity, differences, and separation in the community, in the church, in the prayer fellowship, wherever you are involved? That's why, may the Lord bless us today, so that we can recognize the important need, so that we must be peacemakers. We must have the mind of Jesus Christ, forgiving others, humbling ourselves, and also, though we live in diversity, differences, but live in unity. And continue with this wonderful, wonderful privilege of mission. That means taking the message of Jesus to others in these last days. So that some people can be saved through what you do. So that's why we want to tell you that, may the love of Jesus prevail, and love of Jesus can guide us for His glory and honor. That's why I want to appeal to each one of you, those who are online, as well as those who are here at the site of where we are studying in Spicer. May the grace and peace of Jesus fill us and bless us so that we can truly live every day, not only once in a week. Many times we think, okay, once in a week we have the worship day and we come for the worship. That day we want to be just like a good person, a saint. But remaining 6 days, how do we live? Every day we must live the same life as the sons and daughters of Jesus, so that it will bring glory and honor to Jesus. And whoever looks at us, that will give convincing proof to the others that this person is truly a follower of Jesus. May the Lord help us so that others can see the power of Jesus, the grace of Jesus in our own lives. And let's pray. Before I pray, and I want to thank those who are joining online each week and also sharing with their friends and family members and sharing even online. And I know those of you are here also doing sharing also with your friends who are far away. And may the Lord bless each one of us so that we will get the message across. Each one of us need to do something in these last days. And let's pray. Loving Father, we want to thank you today. We want to praise your name because you have called us to live as your sons and daughters in these last days. Not many times we are failing, but thank you, Jesus, for your unfailing love and your abundant grace, which sustains us to continue to come closer to you. Bless each one of us so that we will truly represent you as our Heavenly Father. And send us with your blessing and that zeal so that we can be united in this mission to take the gospel to others so that many can be saved. Lord, you're coming. We know that you're coming soon. Help each one of us to prepare ourselves and prepare our families and prepare others also for your eternal kingdom. Until that time. And thank you, Lord, for bringing us to the end of November, the last now Sabbath. God bless us, Lord, as we'll be stepping into another month, the last month of this year. And take care of us. And we again plead for your mercy on those who are in need of you, who are in need of good health, and who are looking for your blessing. Continue to take care of our university and the school also here. And bless the children's program today, those who are going to sing and to preach today. And send us with your blessing, because I pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. God be with each one of you. God bless you. Until we meet again next week. I know next week will be the next month, the last month of this year, December. So God bless each one of us. And thank you for joining us. And invite your friends and others and bring them next time when you come. And thank you for joining us here as well as online. God be with you.